Welcome to worship this All Saints Day. As a part of our worship today, we will be acknowledging family members and friends who have passed away during the last 12 months since last All Saints Day. We will also take some time to acknowledge those who, through the gift of holy baptism, have been claimed as God's children. Our first hymn today is one of those All Saints great hymns, number 422. We'll sing verses 1, 2, 6, and 7 of For All the Saints, hymn number 422. At this time, we ask our ushers to wait upon us as we share our offerings, and I have a couple of announcements I'd like to bring to your attention. All right, thank you. And as we continue our worship, just a couple of announcements to make. First of all, this coming Thursday is our meatball dinner, the annual meatball dinner. It's a great, great thing, and it's a lot of fun. So far, people have signed up to bring lots of goodies and have signed up to be there as helpers. What we need now is people who will actually just walk through the doors Thursday night and say, "I want to eat." And if you can come, you can bring somebody with you who might like to eat good food as well. And I pretty much promise you it will be great food. It always has been, you know. I mean, there's always a first time for something, but it's been good every single year, and I believe it will be this year too. Just to let you know, in our church community, a dear friend of mine recently passed away this week, Pastor Van Bredesen. Van was youth and family pastor at Bethel Lutheran Church in Hudson for many, many years, recently at Christ Lutheran up in Somerset. And he's about my age, a little younger than me. And what a shock to really the whole community, to the churches that he has served. But please remember Van's family in your prayers, and also the churches where he has served, and especially now Christ Lutheran up in Somerset, where he was recently serving as the pastor. Visitation is on Tuesday evening at Bethel Highlands Church. That's the one on this side of town, close to the Target, and that's from 4 to 7. And funeral for Van Bredesen is Wednesday at 11 o'clock, and that will also be at Bethel Lutheran Church. So please remember them in your prayers. We will receive our offering at this time. Thank you, Hunter. Thank you.
All Saints Sunday is very special in our church calendar year. It reminds us of all the people that have gone before us. And in the bulletin, Pastor will explain the people that have passed away just this last year in our congregation. We honor them, and to honor those that went quite a few years ago, and sometimes still get asked to sing this song in Norwegian for the people that enjoy that. So therefore, I'm doing one verse in Norwegian, and the rest will be in English.
Thank you.
Thank you, Elaine. Thank you, Judy. Beautiful, beautiful old song. We continue as we offer the prayer of the day that is printed in your worship folder. Please join me as we pray. Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first lesson today is found in Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 through 17. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tent over them. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center before the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The gospel is found in Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is God's word.
Thanks be to God. Thank you. Today our in between services, our fourth grade kids met. We were talking about baptism, and as I was meeting with them, I said, "You know, we as a church have spent a lot of time talking every year with our kids about Holy Communion. Our fifth graders gather for that, and we learn the Ten Commandments in Sunday school. During our offering, we often say the Lord's Prayer and the Apostles' Creed, and the one part of the catechism that we have left out of our teaching to our children for many years is holy baptism, and that's where it all begins. And so we gathered over here to talk a little bit about the sacrament, this gift of grace in which God claims us as his children. And so in our fourth grade, there were a couple of kids who were just baptized during this last year. Many of the kids were baptized as infants, And I said, you know, when I was a child, I don't remember it. I was only 2 months old. But what I know for a fact is that my mom and dad made a promise to me. And they kept that promise. And I am grateful for that. And I think as we gather as family and friends in this church, you know, God claims us as his children. That makes us all brothers and sisters in Christ. And so as we gather here, we need each other. And we should be grateful to God. We should be grateful to the people who led the way in faith. You know, if there was one spark of faith that was lit, maybe it would be good to say thanks to that person if possible. If not, we pass that spark of faith along to the next person. And so we gathered at the font and we remember that it is because of God's saving work that we have been claimed as God's children. As we heard from the book of Revelation today, one of the scripture readings today, we realize that the book of Revelation is a fascinating book of the Bible. It's a prophetic book. It is a mysterious book. It is a book of faith that baffles our minds as it speaks of the spiritual realm that few of us have any understanding of. It speaks of beasts and fires and thrones. It shares heavenly visions. It also shares visions of destruction and hell. As mysterious as this book of the Bible is to all of us today, there are some scholars, okay? There are some people who get it, and they've read maybe thousands of books that help them understand more about this mysterious book, but just about every scholar in the book of Revelation believes that the people who first read this book of the Bible really understood it. They understand all of it, that it was not a mystery to them, but that these strange things that we try to decipher, that they all understood, and they read it very, very seriously. That early Christian church was a church that lived under the threat of persecution. They were persecuted because of their faith. They were persecuted by the Greeks in that world, kind of in the Western world at the time. And the Greeks did not appreciate the foolishness of the cross, they called it. And the Apostle Paul understood exactly what they were talking about. He talks frequently about the foolishness or the folly of the cross of Jesus Christ. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, when the Apostle Paul was writing to the Christian church in Corinth, they knew so well about the foolishness of the cross that he spends a good share of that opening chapter to that letter just talking to them about that. Read 1 Corinthians chapter 1 sometime, verses 18 through 31, a rather large portion of that chapter talks about this. He says, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Later in that chapter, he says, we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, foolishness to the Greeks. The early Christians were looked upon everywhere they went as people who lived against the grain of the culture. Whatever society they lived in at that time, they were countercultural. The Greek culture was one of wisdom, and the Christians were seen as fools in that society. The Jewish culture was one of a steadfast religious faith, and the Christians were seen as against that culture as well. The Christians did not have a king on earth, but they talked about a king that was somewhere in heaven. Nobody could understand what that was all about. And so they pledged no allegiance to any earthly kingdom. I suppose if those Christians were living in this country today, we would persecute them as well, just on that grounds alone, pledging allegiance to no one but God. The early Christians were persecuted by the Greeks and the Jews. And as the chosen people of God, the Jewish people looked at them as a threat to their religion because these early Christians used the Hebrew scriptures. They used the Bible of the Jews, but they insisted this Bible is not complete. You can understand how the Jews then would not be very appreciative of what these people were saying about their own Bible and about their own faith. And then they talked about the old covenant that was made with Abraham, but they said there's a new covenant now, but that new covenant was with Jesus, and the Jews of that day saw Jesus as being a heretic. How could this heretic fulfill the words of their scriptures? The Christians knew Jesus of Nazareth to be the Christ, and they said he is the long-awaited Messiah. Now, both the Jews and the Greeks they didn't like each other either. The Jews hated the Greeks, and the Greeks hated the Jews. And here's this terrible triangle of Jew and Greek and Christian, and there's so much hate going on between all of these groups, but we find that the battleground makes for some strange lovers, and unions can be made where there is a common enemy. And the early Christians were the common enemy of both the Jews and the Greeks. Persecution of Christians occasionally resulted in death. It was not nearly as widespread of killing of Christians as what I had anticipated. I was looking at that this week, and it said most of the persecution of the early Christians was with financial and political exclusion. And so these early Christians were cut out of their society in those ways, sanctions set up to keep Christians from buying food and from living in their communities. Just a lot of finger pointing and a lot of saying, oh, no, you can't be here. We won't serve you. That kind of hatred was leveled against them in such a way as to try to drive them out of the communities that they lived in. This revelation speaks about that kind of hatred of people who believed in Jesus. And this revelation spoke about the temporary pain that these Christians would feel because of living in this self-righteous world, saying to the people of Christ, be patient, because the struggles of this world are temporary compared with the eternal glory that waits for you. So the revelation was good news, even if living in that society was so difficult. And in Revelation 7, today we heard these words, behold a host arrayed in white. These are the people who will meet you in the life that is yet to come. Those are words of that old song, that special music that Elaine shared with us. Behold a host arrayed in white, reminding these early Christians that those who live faithfully, committed to Jesus Christ, those who are willing to accept death because of their faith, those who are willing to accept the rejection of their peers because they stand with Jesus, have that gift of eternal life. And that host arrayed in white, in all purity, are the ones who will greet us when we cross over to that life that for us is yet to come. So a question comes to my mind, should Christians be persecuted because of their faith? Should we be persecuted because we believe in Jesus? Opinions vary on that, widely vary on that. And you can get all kinds of opinions from people who say that persecutions should be fought with words, and persecution should be fought with weapons, and in many other ways in this world. I guess my opinion, whether I am right or wrong, I really have no clue. But I do have an opinion about this, and my thought is, if I am killed because I believe in Jesus, then so much the better for this life. I don't look forward to dying, you know what I'm saying? But I am not afraid to meet my Savior. And there are people who will be cruel in this life, and no amount of fighting against them will change their cruelty. But to live faithfully for Jesus provides a reward that no one can explain and no one can give in any other way. Another side note, persecution is not the domain only of people who are enemies of Christ. Christians have notably been terrible persecutors as well. And sometimes Christians persecute and ignore and chase away people that they feel are different somehow, not worthy of the name of Christ. All in all, in my opinion, that too is persecution. And we, of all people, should not be excluding anyone from the presence of Christ. I've said it before that human might does not necessarily make right. Godly might, on the other hand, is revealed throughout the pages of this revelation that is at the end of our Bible, and the godly might is always revealed on the cross of Christ. That doesn't make sense, does it? That's the foolishness of the cross. So where do we look for power in our lives? In giving our lives away to Jesus. And so if that means to live, or if that means to die, then we live and we die with Christ. If it is in celebration or sorrow, if it is in pain or in wellness, if it is in wealth or in poverty, we do that all with the blessings of Christ. Everyone who looks to God will be blessed. And these blessings that we have received all need to be shared. That's a part of what it means to be a Christian in this world. It's true that there are some things that separate Christians from other religions. We were talking in our class with the fourth graders today. Said, after we die, what happens? One of the kids said, our soul comes back in another person? And I said, well, no. That's Hinduism, actually. That's not Christianity. And what happens is that God claims us as his children in holy baptism. And another one of the kids said, we go to heaven? And it's like, yeah, we do. We don't know what that's like, though, right? We have not yet been there. But that's part of the mystery of this revelation. That too will be revealed to us one day, even if we can't see it right now and don't know where it is. But there are some things that we share with other religions, and there are some things that do actually bring us together so that we're not too self-righteous, right? So that we don't think we've got everything and everybody else is all wrong. The Jews who persecuted the Christians during that first century, we find that we do share the same scripture with them. And Jesus didn't come to abolish the old covenant, the Old Testament. Jesus came to fulfill it. And if you read in the book of Hebrews, that's kind of towards the end of the New Testament, The book of Hebrews is a fascinating thing because it was written to the Hebrews and who were now Christians. And they say, you know, that these people who were in the Old Testament have led the way of faith for us. And it gives many, many, many examples of people in the Old Testament who really lead the way for us as Christians today. One of those Old Testament people was Abraham. We meet him in the book of Genesis in chapter 12. God gives Abraham a blessing. And we just keep reading about the blessing that God gave to Abraham, and God gave Abraham another blessing. And then it's a little bit later in Genesis 27, God says, "Now, Abraham, I have given you the blessing. You have to give it to somebody else." And so that's where God changed things. In Genesis 27, Abraham gave his blessing to his son Isaac. And then Isaac later gave that same blessing to his son Jacob. And then Jacob gave that same blessing to his children and through the generations until now we have all received that same blessing from the people who have come before us. And we are told in God's word that we are blessed so that we can be a blessing to others. Part of the blessing of being a child of God is that we share that blessing with the people around us. As the early Christians saw how cruel the world could be, the Word of God always encouraged those people to never fight evil with more evil. It just doesn't work. There is no getting even. There is no paying back. Instead,